practicing the biblical principles of what a church should be and manifesting the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the Hour of Faith, originating from the sanctuary of Faith Baptist Church, Altoona, Pennsylvania, 315 40th Street in the Highland Park section of the city. As you participate in today's broadcast, may the Lord challenge your heart with the Word.
Thank each and every one of you who are joining us today from wherever you might be over the Faith Baptist Church of Altoona, Pennsylvania Media Ministries. And it's a delight to have you there. And we do thank you so very, very much for the pleasure of your company. And we just had the opportunity of singing that great hymn, In the Garden. And I trust that you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, and that every day you walk with Him, you talk with Him, you fellowship with Him, and you sense His power and His presence in your life. And certainly, if you do not know Jesus Christ as Savior, it is our prayer that you will come to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ today. And if you make that decision for the Lord, please contact us here at the church so that we might be able to send you some information that will help you to get started right in your Christian life, your new Christian life. I encourage you to go to our website, which is www.fbcaltoona.org, for there you can learn more about our ministry. And we certainly would be delighted to minister to you in any spiritual way that we can. If you have a prayer request, send it in to us, and we will take you, your prayer request, and you to God's throne of grace in that particular special way. And so we invite you indeed to do that. As we all know, here in the United States of America, and of course we also realize that some of you are watching by the internet around the world, but here in the United States of America, we have recently inaugurated a new president. His name happens to be Donald Trump. And we want to encourage you, no matter where you are today, wherever you're living today, whatever your political party may be today, it is our prayer that you will pray for our newly inaugurated president, that he might truly have the sense of God's presence in his life, and that he might be able to lead this nation according to biblical and constitutional principles and truth, without which there really is not a strong nation. The Bible tells us that righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. And we must pray that in the United States of America, there will be righteousness lived here. We had about 13 people go from Faith Baptist Church of Altoona to the inauguration, and we distributed 40,000 Gospels of John and the Book of Romans. It was a great day, and we ask you to pray that people will read those books of the Bible and come to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus. Also, here at Faith Baptist Church today, we are standing for life. Right to life is something that the Word of God teaches, because life is sanctified. It comes directly from God. God is the one who's the giver of life and the taker of life. And, for many years, ever since 1973, abortion has been legal in the United States of America, but it has not been biblically lawful. There's a difference between the two. And we believe that when a person aborts a child, that's been an act of murder. Just recently, some of those of us who live in the central Pennsylvania area here know that a fella shot and killed a mother and the baby that was in her womb and got put up for double homicide. Think about that. But yet, that baby could have been aborted and everybody would have said everything's okay. It's not. It's God who gives life, and the taking of life in any way is violating God's law. But here in central Pennsylvania, we've got a ministry called Precious Life. Scott Maganella leads that. Many of us know him. And he has put out this little brochure that we have in our bulletin today. And maybe some of you who go to other churches, maybe this was in your bulletin as well. But he says, for over 30 years, this has been the mission of Precious Life: to defend, to rescue, and to deliver. And that, of course, comes from Psalm 82, verses 3 and 4. But Scott puts in this particular flyer these statistics, which I think we can thank the Lord for. For over 30 years, this has been our mission. But since 1988, the number of abortions in our Tri-County service area has dropped almost 50%. Now, that means Blair County, Cambria County, and Bedford County. He goes on to say that nationally, the number of abortions has dropped by over 30%. He also says that a strong majority of millennials consider themselves pro-life. That's 53%. And then he says, we are moving the culture from a culture of death to one that values life. And so we need to pray for this. And I fully believe that we have an administration in Washington, D.C. right now that could lead us back to life in America. A little bit later on in the service today, I'm going to be delivering a message entitled, Now that we Have a New President, What Should We Do? Well, there's a lot that we should do, a lot that we must do, a lot that we can do, and one of the things that we should, must, and can do is pray that those who are in positions of authority will lead this nation back to God. I invite you to stay tuned, because I'm going to share in my message how many people in the current presidential cabinet know the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. And it's because of things like that that I believe that we could lead this nation back to supporting life and reversing Roe versus Wade that goes back to 1973. But I encourage you to continue to pray for Precious Life, Scott Maganella, and their ministry, that God will use them triumphantly and victoriously in standing for life principles here in central Pennsylvania. Now, we're going to sing a song in our congregation here. It's number 334, The Light of the World is Jesus. We ought to have our candles, shouldn't we? We usually sing this as a part of our Christmas Eve service, and then hold up the candles. Remember how we do that? That the light of the world is Jesus? And so, we don't have our candles, but He truly is the light. Amen. Let's sing this gloriously, number 334. You folks join us by Media Ministries and sing it as well.
Amen. you may be seated.
Master, may I be so honest? Could I admit the way I feel? I'm hurting, it seems that you've forsaken. I wonder, is your love for me still real? Though my friends think I am happy, unaffected by this trial, they can't see the pain I'm hiding underneath my smile. Master, I can't live this way anymore. So today I make my choice. I choose to believe that you are faithful, and my heart is in your hands. And this mystery that I face today is part of a greater plan. I choose not to be discouraged, though the sun will not break through. I have the choice of trusting you. So, Lord, this is what I choose. I know this road will not be easy. I know I'll have my weaker days, and Satan will tell me I don't mean it when I say I'll trust God all the way. But it really doesn't matter. I refuse to hear him out. With my faith I'll find the power to overcome all doubt. Lord, I've never felt so strong as when I'm resting in your arms. I choose to believe that you are faithful, and my heart is in your hands. And this mystery that I face today is part of a greater plan. I choose not to be discouraged, though the sun will not break through. I have the choice of trusting you. So, Lord, this is what I choose. I choose to be. Is part of a greater plan. I choose not to be discouraged, though the sun will not break through. I have the choice of trusting you. So, Lord, this is what I choose. This is what I choose. I'm gonna trust you, Lord.
choice is to trust the Lord. And I trust that you will make that your choice in every aspect of your life. If you've not yet trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I encourage you to do that. And if you have, continue to trust Him in your life. Well, take your copy of God's Word, if you would please, today, and turn with me to 1 Timothy and the second chapter. 1 Timothy, the second chapter, I'd like to read verses 1 through 6 of this great passage of God's Word. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 6, and I invite you to stand out of respect for God's Word as I read and you follow along. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. The Word of God says, I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word, for it is truth. And I pray that as we study your truth today, that you would teach us truth through the power and the presence of your Holy Spirit in our lives. And then, Lord, I pray that we will respond to your truth in living a life that glorifies you from this point on. And we'll give you the praise and the thanksgiving for it in Jesus' name. And all of God's children said, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Well, here in America, we've recently had a brand new president inaugurated with an administration that will lead our nation for at least the next 4 years. And the question that comes before us all this morning is, how should Christians respond to that? Now, there may be several choices. For instance, we can complain a lot about it. But if we do, we are violating the words of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who said in John chapter 6 and verse 43, murmur not among yourselves. So if we set out and complain for that which has transpired, then it's unto Jesus that we need to answer and give an account. Or we can be indifferent about this new president that has been inaugurated. We can say, well, whatever. Doesn't that word drive you nuts? Whatever. You know, the concept of whatever should not be in the vocabulary of action for born-again believers, because we are never to be indifferent about anything. We are always to be biblically minded about everything that comes our way. So if we say, well, whatever, as it relates to the new president, then that's not a biblical approach to take. Another choice we have is that we can argue and fight with others who do not agree with us. Well, the Bible tells us that the servant of the Lord must not strive. Let's not be out there arguing and fighting. That is certainly not the approach. I mean, I am certain that individuals in this administration are going to make decisions that you and I don't agree with. But the way to deal with it is not to argue and fight and disagree with others, but, to pray about it, watch God work. A fourth choice we have is that we can have no involvement at all with national and governmental matters. Not good for the Christian. Why do I say that? I say that simply because of the fact that God has ordained only three institutions. One has been the what? Family. The second has been the church. And the third one has been civil government. Albeit, we need to recognize that the second institution was civil government. The family was ordained back in Genesis 2. The civil government was ordained in Genesis chapter 9. And then, of course, the church in Acts chapter 2. And so, you see, we have a responsibility to be involved in all three of God's institutions. We so often say, well, I'm going to be involved with the family and I'm going to be involved with the church. Yeah, that's true. But don't neglect government. I'm not saying be political. I am saying be involved in government. And you've been around this church long enough to know there's a big difference between the two. Those are four choices. There's a fifth choice that we can have as it relates to this new administration, and that is we can get involved with national and government matters, and we should. And then the sixth choice is this. We can pray and ask God to do a work in this new administration. We can pray and ask God to do a work in this new administration. The first four of those six choices I gave should be rejected and will be rejected by every Bible-believing, born-again Christian who wants to stand for truth. But those last two should be things that every one of us should be involved with. Getting involved in God's institution of government and praying and ask God to do a work in this new administration. Today we've had the opportunity of reading from 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 6, a passage that we're all very, very familiar with. And in this particular passage, we've got some teaching concerning how we ought to respond to this new president, this new administration, whether we voted for him or not. And I'd like for us today to draw these particular principles out of this passage, that as we go from this point, we will be responding to this administration in a biblical way. Now, in looking down through these first six verses of 1 Timothy chapter 2, we find that the overall point of emphasis is that Christians are exhorted to what? Pray for those who are in positions of authority. Indeed, we are to pray for all people, but he says in verse 2, for kings and all that are in authority. And as we look at this passage of Scripture, we see that Christians are exhorted not only to pray, but to utilize the four main components of prayer. If you attended our week of prayer and our prayer conference that was so adequately taught by Dr. Chris Davis, you will know that he talked about all four of components of prayer. And if you've missed any one of his lessons, I would encourage you to get them and to listen to them. But we see those four words brought out for us right here in the first verse of chapter 2, where the Word of God says, I exhort therefore, and by the way, this isn't a suggestion, it is a command of Scripture, that first of all, the word first of all, the phrase first of all means of priority. The priority is that all of us as believers are to be involved with supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving thanks. There you see the four components of prayer that we are to be rendering in relationship to all people and to government, and certainly applying it to this new administration. Dr. Chris clearly identified what each one of these particular words stand for. Supplication means praying seriously and earnestly until you see God work. And I think that that's something that is needed to be more and more readily here in the United States of America. No matter what we're praying for, not just, hey, God help, but be praying earnestly and seriously as we see God work. Then it tells us here we are to pray. That is the term for general communication with God. We had the opportunity of singing that song, and he walks with me and talks with me and tells me I am his own. You know, that's the concept of continual talking with God to build that relationship with him. Then he tells us that we are to be involved with intercessions. That means praying specifically for others. I read an article just recently that said that one of the least elements of prayer that is being used today is interceding for others. Is that the case in your life? So many times we pray for me, don't we? Help me, Lord, get me through this, Lord. Lord, I need this, Lord, I need that. Give me, Lord. But when we pray for one another, we are going to see God work. And by the way, when we pray for one another, it'll be important. It'll be easier for us not to complain about them. So the next time you see a person you want to complain about, pray for them. Watch how God will change you. You thought I was going to say, watch how God would change them, didn't you? We might. It'll change you first. Supplication, prayer, intercession. Then he says giving thanks. That's thanking God for what he has done and what he will do. And every prayer that we render, we should say, Lord, thank you for the way that you're going to work this out. Thank you for the answer that you're going to send. Now we see that Paul says that when we render supplications and prayers and intercessions and giving you thanks, that this is a good thing. Look at verse 3. He says, "For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior." Why is that? Why is it acceptable unto God when we supplicate and pray and intercede and give thanks? Well, just take a look at the text. First of all, it's good because it enables us to live a quiet and peaceable life. You see it there in verse 2? That we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. The more we pray, the more quiet and peaceable life we'll be able to live. The second reason is that why this is good and acceptable unto God is simply because of the fact that it brings salvation of souls. He says in verse 4, "Who will have all men to be saved and come unto the knowledge of the truth?" When you and I are involved in praying and giving thanks, souls get saved. That's good and acceptable unto God. The third reason why praying and in supplicating and interceding and giving your thanks is significant is because it enables us to recognize who God is. For verse 5 says, "For there's one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus." And then the fourth reason why this is good and acceptable unto God to pray is simply because of the fact that it becomes the opportunity, as it were, to get out an evangelistic message to all, because it says there in verse 6, as it relates to Christ, who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. If we pray for those in authority, and let's bring it down home, if we pray for this current administration, and if we use all the elements of prayer here, supplication, praying, intercession, and giving of thanks, then we are going to please God. We will live a more quiet and peaceable life. We will see souls saved. We will have a greater understanding of who God is. And we will have an opportunity to evangelize. I want to make an admission. And that admission is this, that I fully believe that one of the reasons why we have the serious troubles that we have in America today is because we, as God's people, have not applied this text to our lives. This is a good time to start at the beginning of a new administration. I want to take this first verse and just pull out of it two principles that we should be applying to our lives now that we have a new president. Number one, we should be thankful. Christians should be thankful. And number two, Christians should be prayerful. First of all, Christians must be thankful. And I want to just basically give you several reasons why and even apply it to this current administration. Number one, let's be thankful for a peaceable transition of power. You know, a number of us were in Washington, D.C. the other day, and we were very, very close to where this took place. We were a quarter of a mile from where this peaceable transition of power took place between President Obama and President Trump. One of our own, Mike Dahl, was even closer. He drove his bus right into the Capitol building. Not literally, but he was right there with it. And you know, it was a peaceful transition. Oh, yeah, there were some people there who were rioting and doing what they do. But this is something that is not seen in most nations of the world. Most nations of the world, there's all sorts of fear and wondering what's going to happen. But you know what? It has taken place 45 times in the United States of America, and we ought to give thanks to that. Let's give thanks for the peaceable transition of power. Secondly, let's thank God for an administration, and I'm going to use this next phrase cautiously, but dogmatically. Let's thank God for an administration that appears to have a respect for God in leading our nation. And I say that appears to be having a respect for God in leading our nation. Why do I say that? Well, let's take a look at the new president, Donald Trump. We have mentioned it before that he has no less than 25 spiritual advisors around him consistently, who are evangelical, who are fundamental, and who give him biblical truth. And if you saw his speech the other day, he ended it and he said, God will protect us. Well, God will protect us if the administration leads us according to biblical truth. You could be Democrat, Republican, Independent, Green, Purple, I don't care what party you might be. But we need a president who listens to spiritual advice. And we need to be thankful for that. In addition to that, Vice President Mike Pence has had a long history of walking with the Lord. Mike Pence is a Bible-believing, born-again Christian who goes to a solid church. I've known Mike Pence for about 15 years. I can't believe he's vice president. Why? Because he acts like Ken Patterson all of the time. He's a joker. I don't know, Ken ran out the door, I think. But I've not seen any of that kind of action. But he knows the Lord and he loves the Lord. We need to be thankful for that. Then what about the new cabinet members? I'd heard that a number of them had come to Christ or knew the Lord. I found out just yesterday from Jim O'Brien that 9 of the current selected cabinet members, if they get approved, 9 of them are Bible-believing, born-again Christians out of the 15. I also found out yesterday, many of you know that I'm associated with Capital Ministries, Ralph Drollinger, solid Bible-believing evangelical man who teaches Bible studies in capitals of the world, local and federal. He wrote yesterday that 4, think of this, 4 out of the 15 new cabinet members have regularly for years been praying with and supporting his ministry in getting the Word of God out to capitals. You see what I'm saying? That God seemingly is bringing together a group of people to stand for biblical truth. We need to be thankful for that. Then, thirdly, let's thank God for a renewed support of Israel in this administration. Is it not true that in this last administration, we find that I think that the administration did not like Israel the way we ought to, and in many ways shunned Benjamin Netanyahu, and would like to see a section of Israel, particularly around Jerusalem, guarded off as a place for the Palestinian nation. That's not biblical in any way, shape, or form. But you know what? We have an administration right now that says Israel is going to be our best friend. I trust that's true. We need to be thankful for that. Because Genesis chapter 12 still says that those who bless Israel will be blessed by God. Those who curse Israel will be cursed by God. I'm thankful for an administration that will appear to support the nation of Israel. Number 4, let's thank God for giving us an administration that has promised to nominate Supreme Court justices that are conservative, constitutional, and pro-life. You know, it's the Supreme Court that interprets the law. Had someone else won the election, that other individual wanted the people on the Supreme Court to reflect all of America. That's not what the Supreme Court's for. The one who won this election said, I want a Supreme Court that is constitutional. That's what the Supreme Court is for. And if indeed he does have the opportunity to recommend new justices, I'm thankful that for what we know, there'll be conservative, constitutional, and pro-life, and we ought to be thankful for that. Number 5, let's thank God for a president, listen to this, who has encouraged pastors to preach the gospel. You say he did? Well, yeah, I told you that before. Remember? Having the opportunity of going up to New York in July to meet with Donald Trump, he said, I can't understand it. Why is it that you men who are seemingly intelligent, when you walk in the pulpits, you don't really preach hard what you believe? Somebody said to him, well, it's the Johnson Amendment of the IRS code that says pastors may be penalized if they preach certain things. Donald Trump said, if I'm elected, we are going to reverse the Johnson Amendment to the IRS code. Now, I don't know, it's going to take time if he ever does it. But what he said, you preachers need to preach what God puts in your mind. I heard him say that. Now, you know, you Baptists, that ought to thrill you. You Christian, it ought to thrill you. I don't care what party you are. This preacher does not need to have a president to tell him what to preach. This preacher is never pressured to preach what you like. That's called cupcake sermons. This preacher seeks God's direction no matter who says what, to preach what God wants him to preach. But we need preachers all across this nation that will do that. And I'm thankful for a president who will support that. Aren't you? Amen. Number six, let's thank God for a more conservative Christian vote this particular cycle. And it's true that more conservative Christians did vote. Number seven, let's thank God for giving America a national and spiritual reprieve. You say, what do you mean by that, Pastor Gary? America was going down the wrong road. We were going down the road of more secularism. We were going down the road of more unrighteousness. We were going down the road of rejecting Israel. But I think that in this administration, God has given us a reprieve. And it's not all in the hands of the people that sit in Washington, D.C. This reprieve brings a great responsibility upon you and I who are Christians to take the opportunity to preach the gospel, to live the gospel, to stand up for truth in every aspect of our lives, that we might be able to see America turn back to God. And then finally, let's thank God for being the one who sets up presidents. And I want you to understand that, oh yeah, we voted. I hope you did. But it's God who put that person into office. It's God who put that person into office. Say that with me. It's God who put that person into office. From the president right down to the local dog catcher, that is true. Because over in Romans chapter 13 and verse 1, the Word of God clearly says this, which I read to you. Romans chapter 13 and verse 1, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers, for there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. In God's sovereignty, He put in the current administration. He might have used our vote, but God did it. God is providential. God is sovereign. God is the one who put everybody in office from the president down to the lowest elected position. Let's thank God that God is in control. I was talking to different people in the election, and when they began to be concerned about the way the election was going, I would say, God is in control. And a good many Christians said, I hope so. No hope about it. It is true. God is in control, and He's the one who causes, allows, or directs all things to happen. Thank God for that. If God wasn't in control, we would have need to fear. But since He's in control, we can rest peacefully in confidence that God will work all things out for His glory and our good. Amen. And so let's be thankful. As the Word of God says, I exhort therefore that first of all, supplication, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and all that are in authority. The second principle I derive from this, though, is that Christians must be prayerful. Now look, we must be prayerful. We must be prayerful. I mean, that's something that the Word of God tells us anyway. Jeremiah 33:3, call unto me and I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Jesus says, ask and it shall be given, seek and ye shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you. James says, the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man does what? Availeth much. And yet prayer is probably the least spiritual tool brought out of the toolbox of Christianity. And I'm quoting Alex Sitman because he made that reference to that in the service earlier today. Prayer is the greatest tool that God has given us. When we pray, God works. And yet so many times we see that prayer is so forgotten in the life of the Christian. Look at your average prayer meeting. You call together a big concert, you'll fill a place. You call together a time to prayer, not filled. Why? Well, number one, we're disobeying God because we're not praying. But secondly, we don't probably really think that prayer does work. Prayer does change things. Mainly, it changes our attitude to what God's doing. But it changes things. And he says, I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, and intercessions be made. You say, what should we pray for? Well, first of all, let's pray for a foundation of righteousness in America. Let's pray for a foundation of righteousness in America. You see, the only foundation that will honor God and bring His blessing upon this nation is the foundation of righteousness. Remember Proverbs 14:34? Righteousness what? Exalts a nation, but sin is a what? Reproach to any people. You know, you and I need to pray daily that righteousness will be the foundation of our nation. You say, what is righteousness? It's biblical truth. It is that which is right with God. It is that which is true to the Word of God. It is that which is in compliance with the leading of the Holy Spirit of God. And one of the problems is today that we have seen an escape of righteousness from individual lives to family lives to church life to the national life. And right now, more than any other time in our history, we ought to pray that righteousness will once again be the foundation of this nation as it was when this nation was founded. The second thing that we should be praying for is, let's pray for wisdom for the administration to govern biblically. To govern biblically. I know you're all taking all of this down. I can see it. I can see how you're all writing notes somewhere. I hope you're not just texting it, a love letter to somebody. I hope you're taking these down mentally, physically. These are important principles, very important principles. Pray for wisdom for the administration to govern biblically. And you say, I say administration, but any elected official. You say, well, what all would that include? Well, at least three things. Number one, let's pray for international relations, and particularly with the nation of Israel. Let us pray that this administration will be stronger towards Israel than any other administration ever in the history of America since 1948. We need to be friends of Israel. And when we are friends of Israel and stand with Israel and pray for Israel, we will see God bless. But then secondly, as we pray for wisdom for the administration to govern biblically, let us pray that they will make biblical policies and decisions in every element of their governance. I could list a lot of them here, but may I list four? Let's pray that they will make biblical policies towards the family. That the family is, according to God, a relationship between a man and a woman, not two men, not two women, never has been, never will be. Because God created Adam and Eve and not Adam and Steve. And so, you see, we need to pray that our government will support biblical family truth. Then another biblical policy that we should pray that they support is the matter of life. Today is the Sanctity of Life Sunday across this nation. And as I said earlier, even though abortion is legal in the United States, it is not biblically lawful. Let us pray that through the leadership in Washington, we will see a reversal of Roe versus Wade. Thirdly, in another biblical policy, let's pray that God will have space in America through this administration. In recent years, God has been put out in the back seat. Kids can't sing Christmas carols at public schools today. How shameful. In many places, it's illegal to have the Ten Commandments posted in front of a building. How shameful. Listen, we need to pray that our administration will work to bring policies into fruition that exalts God. And then the fourth thing, let's pray that our administration will make biblical policies that will stand on truth. Truth. Truth, according to the Word of God. The country, the world, the secularism of our world today is saying there is no absolute truth, but there is absolute truth. It's right here in God's Word. And let's pray for an administration that will promote that in every element. You say, I've never seen a presidential administration that's done all that in years. Well, it doesn't mean it can't be done. You read in your Old Testament, you'll find that when Solomon was established as a king, it was said that none like him went before him, and none like him will be after him. Maybe that could be what we could say about our current president. I don't know. But we do need to pray that they will make biblical policies and decisions. And then the third thing to pray for when we're praying for wisdom for the administration is for advancing constitutional law. And I don't want to delve into this, but I remind you, the constitutional law is based on natural law, which is God's law, which is why our Constitution has existed down through these years. And let's pray that every choice that our administration makes will support constitutional law. Number three, let's pray for Christians to promote and support biblical worldview in all three of God's institutions. I've already touched on this, but I think it needs to be a matter of serious prayer. Let's pray for Christians to promote and support a biblical worldview in all three of God's institutions. Number one, for the family. As I said earlier, according to Genesis chapter 2 and verse 24, God's family is based upon the relationship between a man and a woman only. Let's pray that we will see a return back to that. Let's also pray that Christians will promote and support the biblical worldview in government. We read earlier today from Romans chapter 13 and verse 3 that it is God who establishes those in positions of authority. But we also must recognize, according to Romans chapter 13 and this time in verse 3, that the responsibility of the government is to stand against evil and to stand for good. Let us pray that Christians will pray for, promote, and support a government that will stand against evil and stand and support that which is good. And then thirdly, let's pray for the church. The church has lost its way in many ways. I fully believe that one of the reasons why we've got some issues in this country today is because the church has not been evangelizing. The church is made up of you and me. One individual who went with us to Washington, D.C. the other day said, in essence, I need to get out of my shell and do more evangelistic work. She really enjoyed it. We all need to do that. The church, according to 1 Timothy 3:15, is the pillar and the ground of truth. We hold up the truth of God in this world today, and if the church doesn't hold it up, it won't be held up. So let's pray that we will get back to that. Then, and I must go brief quickly, let's pray for divine intervention to strengthen America biblically and spiritually. I would think that this may be the most serious element of our prayer. That as we go into this new administration, that God would intervene and strengthen this nation from the biblical perspective. We should intercede for our country. We should intercede for our leaders. We should intercede for each and every one, that God would come down in a special way and begin to move in this nation where He will be exalted and lifted up and praised and worshiped. Then number five, let's pray for unity among American citizens. Isn't it sad to see the disunity in this country today? I remind you, we're all one nation under God. I remind you, we are all one people that look up at the same sky every day. And yes, in the United States of America, there is diversity. But when it comes down to principles and policies, let's be united around a Constitution that is biblically true. That we might strengthen this nation in standing for Israel and in spreading forth the gospel of Jesus Christ all around the world, which you've heard me say many times, is I believe that one of the reasons why God brought this nation into existence. If we are divided as a nation, we will fall as a nation. But let's pray that we will be united so that God can be exalted in this nation, so that evangelists and missionaries can go around the world from this nation to preach the gospel, and so that the nation of Israel itself will be supported and strengthened as it should be. And then finally, let's pray for true revival in America. Let's not just talk about revival, but let's pray for it. You've often heard me say that revival is when God's people get right with God. We need to do that. You say, where does revival begin, Pastor Gary? Well, it begins in the individual life, when as Christians we make certain that we are right with God. And then it spreads from the individual life to the home, where the home is Christ-centered. Then it is spread from the home into the church, where the church is committed to biblical truth. And then it is spread from the church into the nation, where the nation will recognize God. That's what I call the process, the progress of revival in culture. It starts when the individual Christian gets right with God. And when the home is Christ-centered, and when the church is committed to God's truth, then that will lead to bringing revival in the land. And that's what we need today. Let's pray for that. And let's pray that individually we will get right with God and live for God and stand for God. Yes, we had the opportunity to go to Washington, D.C. and pass out this commemorative 27 inauguration issue. We had people come up and say, is it free? Yeah, I'll take it. Some of them came back and said, give me two or three more for my family and friend. They took it. In here, it says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. In here it says, all have sinned and have come short of the glory of God. And the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. In here it says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Will you pray with me just a few days after the inauguration that the 40,000 of these that have been distributed, many by members of this congregation, will be read, and that we will begin to hear of a salvation here, of a salvation there, of a salvation over there. God could use these 40,000 pieces of literature to begin a revival in the land. Let's pray for that. Now, certainly if you're under the sound of my voice today and you've never trusted Jesus Christ as Savior, I would encourage you to call upon His name and ask Him to save you. But then let's be committed to being thankful for what we've seen take place in the nation. But let's also be prayerful. Listen, there's more things wrought by God in this world than man dreams of through prayer. As I mentioned during our conference of prayer, look how much we see God work with such little prayer. How much would we see God work with great prayer? Let's make prayer a great element of our life. Yeah, for all people. But not forget the kings and those who are in authority. How much time do you pray for others? How much time do you pray for the president, the governor, the senators, representatives? Really, how much time do you pray? take a good look at that and advance our prayer life. You know, we pray that God will send missionaries to the world, and we must do that. But let's also pray that God will send born-again believers into God's institution of government. I'm thankful that we've got a future senator in our audience. At least he thinks so. We showed him his new office building the other day. He said, I want three of them. He's hunting for them, Hunter Heaton. But let's pray that God will raise up godly people to support and strengthen this nation biblically. Is that too much to ask? No. Let us do it. Let's stand for prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for the opportunity that we've had to study your word. And we just skimmed over these things. But Father, I pray that through your Spirit, you will take these things and apply them to our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Our concluding hymn is going to be 301, Only Trust Him. May this be our challenge. If God has spoken to your heart and you've made the spiritual decision today, want to receive Christ or some other decision, you come. We're here to pray with you. But may this be a challenge to every one of us. Only trust the Lord and watch Him work in every aspect of our life. Number 301.
Participation in our worldwide broadcast of the Hour of Faith, which originated from the sanctuary of Faith Baptist Church, Altoona, Pennsylvania, 315 40th Street in the Highland Park section of the city. Dr. Gary G. Dull and the Family of Faith welcomes you to Sunday school at 9:30, morning worship 10:30, Sunday night service at 6, with youth programs and adult prayer and Bible study Wednesday at 7, with Kids for Truth every Wednesday night at 6:30 during the school year. If we may ever be of further spiritual help to you, please call 814-944-2894. Log on to our website, www.fbcaltoona.org, or write to the Faith Baptist Church at 315 40th Street, Altoona, Pennsylvania.